So welcome back to the next session of today. I'm sorry we are running about 20 minutes behind schedule. The next speaker is Dr. Anil Gupta, who will address us on innovation ecosystems in India. Let me say a few words about Dr. Gupta. He's professor in the Center for Management and Agriculture at the Indian Institute of Management in Ahmedabad. He's also the founder of the Honeybee Network, which many of you know about. Dr. Gupta earned his PhD in management from Kurukshetra University in 1986, and after his master's in biochemical genetics. And he is a fellow of the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, as well as the World Academy of Art and Science in California. Dr. Gupta's mission has been to expand the global as well as local space for innovations at grassroots levels, link ideas in informal and formal sectors, ensure recognition, respect, and reward for creative people, creating knowledge networks for augmenting innovations and unfolding creative potential of individuals, institutions, and societies through frugal, flexible, and friendly, empathetic innovations. He holds a number of positions, including being a member of the National Innovation Council, president of Srishti, which is the Society for Research and Initiatives for Sustainable Technologies and Institutions. He's the editor of the Honey Bee. He's also the executive vice chair of the National Innovation Foundation, as well as the chairperson of the Ravi J. Mathai Center for Educational Innovation. He is an advisor to the Bangladesh Agricultural Research Council and the Research Institute. He has won a number of awards over his career, including the Humanistic Management Lifetime Achievement Award by the Humanistic Management Network, a PhD honoris causa from the San Martin de Porres University in Peru, the Doctor of Letters from Central University of Orissa in 2012, and the Hermes Award from European Institute for Creative Strategies and Innovation. He is also the recipient of a Padma Shri in 2004.
Good morning, friends. This story that I'm going to share with you, particularly at this very happy occasion of the Foundation Day of NIAS, is also an invitation for engagement. Because innovation ecosystem can only become inclusive if different kinds of perspectives are brought to bear on the choices of individuals, institutions, and initiatives at different level. I was telling Nati Tai, Professor Ramuthi, who is here, was the Secretary of Science and Technology at the time when National Innovation Foundation was set up with all kinds of uncertainties and complexities. But very interesting, Professor, that in 2000 when we set up, the income, first year income from the interest rate of 20 crores was 2.2 crore at 11% rate of interest. And the last year's budget was 6.6 crore, which is the same value in real terms as it was in 2000. Now, for 15 years, the foundation has maintained the same level of finance. But what is remarkable, and that's what I want to begin with, how this country, the world itself, is remarkable. And sometimes you don't understand and appreciate it enough. NIS is the only institution, perhaps, which has filed, which could have filed so many patents, 730 patents. No one institution has filed so many. In the name of common people, including children, farmers, artisans. And why, how could we do that with limited resources? If you look at the market rate, the cost would be around 4 lakhs, 3 to 4 lakhs per patent in India. And US patent would be about 15 to 20 lakhs. We have 7 patents in US, 725 in India. And all the patented organizations, top companies of the country, and all of them did not charge for the time. Our average cost is about 15-20,000, that's it. Similarly, when it comes to science, we engage with about 200 scientific labs every year to add, to validate and value add the knowledge of the people. Normally, Professor Ramathi knows that if you look at the expert cost of an average project, it will be about 20-25 lakhs at least in science. Our average cost is 2.5 lakhs, because no scientist charges for his or her time. I'm saying this because one can then understand how can a small organization with limited resources could achieve whatever we could, because there is so much social capital that has been contributed by the scientific community, by the IPR community, by the business organizations, which sometimes is not visible. So first myth that India doesn't cooperate and collaborate is wrong. And I can't say that we are the best epitome of the fact that this could only be accomplished because so many people have shared the mission of Anaya Popular Media Network all these years. Second, that when there is a cause, public cause, people find ways, find both moral and legal ways of helping us. So the rules and regulations of the institutions did not come in the way of hundreds and thousands of scientists who helped us. They have done it with full consciousness that their institute will quote sometimes very high rates for the single experiments to us or as an outsider. But they justified it as a part of co-learning process. They thought their department, their students, their colleagues will learn as much as we would, or the farmers would, and therefore they would justify. So this journey is essentially a journey of collaboration, a journey of cooperation, a journey of co-optation of the missions which appear to all the actors as their common mission. And we also developed some new concepts during this process, so I will share with you. The network essentially started about 25 years ago as a new social movement. And the basic concept is that a nameless, faceless person comes in contact with the network and gets an identity. The logo that is on the right shows you that. In some sense, the matter that gives us a lot of energy to sustain this movement is that a lot of people who innovate don't know that they have innovated. And when they don't know what they have done, so they just go on with their life. Sometimes it is useful for an outsider to come and say, "Thank God, what you have done is very interesting. Why, how did you do that?" And then the person explains. So as I will explain, we walk every 6 months in different parts of the country as a part of the Yatra. Show, as you know, is to explore, the Yatra is to journey. And we walk from village to village and discover knowledge at the grassroots. We also realized that one of the goals of a civilized society should be to honor people, greater people at their doorstep. While we understand that there is a pride in being honored at Rashtrapati Bhavan, and we are very privileged that there is a festival of innovation held at Rashtrapati Bhavan every year. This year, next year, it will be during March 12th to 18th, 2016. We were all invited. Week-long festival of innovation, that's very important, but that can only happen when some people have been identified and scouted, and that process requires us to go to houses and places of the people. The network repurposes the inquiry. As a scholar, as an academician, we all do research, and we do research to ask questions which may not have been asked and find the answers which may not have been obtained. But during this process, we also ask ourselves, do we share our findings with people from whom we collect data? So that is the foundation that we, Honeybee Network, asked 25 years ago. Do we acknowledge them as co-authors? I mean, imagine in a meeting like this, somebody is sitting and documenting all the discussion and then publishes a story on that, and an author of those ideas would not look nice. But that's what we have done. A lot of us have gone to the people, documented their ideas, become authors of those ideas, merely by the act of chronicling them. That didn't seem fair. And in fact, ethnobotany, the discipline of ethnobiology, celebrates extraction. The more extractive you are, the greater scientist, bigger scientist you are, at international level and national level. There was no paper on ethnobotany where people had been acknowledged by name. Never forget about sharing the benefits or sharing the intellectual property rights. So all this asymmetry that existed in the knowledge economy and probably still exists to a large extent, we have not been able to correct all of these asymmetries, were the source of concern when we How can we correct? How can we reverse? How can we create reciprocity and respect in the exchange of ideas and knowledge between formal and informal sector? How can we create a new parity, a new contract, social contract between knowledge producers and formal and informal sector? And I think with NEAS cooperation, we have an understanding with NEAS, and we hope that in due course, the social science research councils, the medical council, the Engineering Institute, the Council, the Academy, all these academies will eventually, I hope, will evolve their code of conduct that will make it impossible for any professional to ever, in future, extract knowledge from the informal sector without due credit, due acknowledgement, and due reciprocity. That's one of the goals. I'm really hoping that NEAS will help us reach that point. First of all, the Raj himself has been president of the Academy of Engineering, and I'm sure one day we should have a meeting of all the Academy presidents here, sir. And we will try to prevail upon them. We will try to persuade them that India must be the first country in the world where all academic scientific bodies and academies should evolve a code of conduct that gives knowledge produced by the informal sector, which is about 78% of our country. In fact, 90%. Only 8% is the organized sector, which is the game. So such a large sector, knowledge produced in such a large sector, we have no norms and rules to deal with that in a systematic and honorable and dignified way. So the norms of accountability have to be redesigned, have to be redefined. And I must concede that, which is not something that we have been able to accomplish adequately in the last 25 years, maybe in the next 25 years we must do that. How do we design the pathways for frugal future? You know, India is on a growth path everywhere we hear this, and it is good. But growth does not necessarily mean ostentatious consumption. It does not necessarily mean that we should waste. I remember when I was a child and we bought something from the market. At that time, Angolas were not that popular. So the shopkeeper will have a thread ball on the top and the thread will be hanging. He will take a piece of paper, put the things in the piece of paper, fold it and tie it with that thread and give it to you. That was the way packaging was done. We came home and my grandfather will say, okay, take your things out. He will take the piece of paper, put it under the bed. There was only one bed in that room where we lived in Old Delhi and my grandparents. And he will hang that thread on a nail. So the next time when something has to be given to somebody, the same piece of paper, the same piece of thread, one piece of thread was not wasted. That is the value that we agree with. Why should that value not be relevant today? What has happened in this country that we have got so much resources now, when with much more people to feed, that we can waste those resources? So I think frugality is not something that must only be a sign of scarcity prone times and lives, but should be much more responsible, much more imperative for those who have affluence. Those who can afford to waste, if they don't waste, they are making a decision, conscious decision. Those who don't have anything to waste, if they don't waste, nothing so special about it. So I think each one of us needs to decide. I'll show you some innovations by children who have tried to deal with this waste, how they do that. Research where the dynamics of things and thoughts, the more expansion things take in our life, the less space we have for thoughts. So if a society has to be thoughtful, our life has to be thoughtful, then surely things should take that seat if possible. So there are four teachers we learn from in every Shodhyatra. Teacher within, teacher around the peers, the teacher in nature, and teacher among common people. These are the four teachers we try to learn from. I'm not saying that all of us, when we walk together, 60, 70 people, sometimes 80 people, sometimes 40 people, in every Shodhyatra, summer we go to places which are hot, winter we go to the places which are cold. So our 35th Shodhyatra was in Tripura last month on the border of Bangladesh, a region where the people who live there, Chakmas, they also live in Bangladesh, they also live here. Difficult to say where they live, but in that place, all of that place was there, because actually the borders came later. But what was most surprising, I was sharing with you something that I learned during this Shodhyatra, which I had never seen before, after walking more than 5,000 kilometers. First time we found healers who had written record for their experiments. Their information about which solution works, which solution may work, which solution may work only with a very little chance, provided the system of the individual responds and cooperates. So they must and should kind of submissions. And then when I asked him a question, and that showed how foolish these scholars and professors like me can be, I said, tell me, what will you do for a cancer? And Anand Kumar, Tripura is also a caste. I mean, a tribe's identity. It's a tribe. So not caste, but tribe. So Anand Kumar Tripura said, that's a very strange question. Don't you know that there are different kinds of cancers? My goodness. He slapped me. It was a slap on my face. Why did I ask such a foolish question? And then he goes further. You know, for different kinds of cancers, there is a set of symptoms, because there are accompanying diseases which occur to people who may have cancer at different stages. Combination of symptoms and the kind of cancer is only when I know that, only I can suggest a cancer, otherwise not. And then he said, let me give you an example. And then he took a combination, and then he says, okay, page number 330 of this volume that he had in his hand, he opened the 330 page of that volume, handwritten manuscript that he had, and tell me what we'd be doing. So I didn't realize that such a good indexation system would be existing. Indexation based on the category of symptoms. Similar symptoms sometimes, maybe for certain other diseases, but he had a way of categorizing them. so that he can go on to those symptoms which accompany the cancer of certain kind. Another thing he told me was that certain kind of cancers, tumorous cancers, need to be treated from outside as well. And he must have been told by some patient that they only get medicine to eat. When he asked them, did doctor give you something to apply on the tumor? He said, no. He said, but I do. Because I can then, by applying outside, also squeeze the source of cells dry, and whatever that inside can give you medicine for that. Now this heuristic we don't have in our modern science, where cancerous tumor has to be treated from outside. We don't have an ointment for a cancerous tumor. So therefore, interaction with the informal sector can create new heuristics, new ways of thinking. After all, cells are permeable warts, and if medicine can be delivered through different routes, one of which is application on the skin. For many diseases we apply, but for many diseases which are inside, we don't apply outside. But we all know when we were a child, our mother will apply a little bit of aspergillus, heme, at nadi. We all must have gone through that, and the gas bowel movement will take place. There was a problem inside for which treatment was from outside. She did not give in a spoon inside the mouth. Though one could have done that, but she, for a little child, it would be too much. So there was a drug delivery system, if I can give the scientific language. The drug delivery system pointed to a particular part of our body, and the nadi was considered to be the right place for delivering that drug. Now this is a heuristic we have ignored. How many modern medicines are applied at naval part? Tell me. And why not? If that's such a good delivery system, delivery mechanism available in the body, why don't we use it more often? Because that's not what modern science would like to deal with. But it's a scientific process. It worked. In all of our lives, it worked. If we have not figured out the science, that's our problem. So I think the cases where we all have experienced certain processes of scientific experience, experiments by in our homes or in our life, the fact that when you wear the cloak of a formal scientific attitude or a scientific professional, we seem to ignore that experience, which is a lived experience, shows the paradox that is to be resolved in times to come, and this show the otherwise essentially both inside and outside we need to discover these things. Now let me mention some of the initiatives that we have taken and some that our president has taken so as to show what kind of ecosystem is evolving. And I will begin with children. Because children are often treated as sink of servants and not as source of ideas. Do this, do that, you are supposed to do this. I mean, children get tired of listening advice from them. I'm sure you ask any child. And one thing that child hates is getting advice all the time from others, as if the child has no cognitive process of taking conscious decisions and understanding and evaluating. My grandfather used to say, don't teach, they observe you all the time. The children observe, they analyze our behavior. They can draw some rules by looking at our behavior. If I'm reading newspaper lying down on a sofa set, and you tell him that, look, please sit straight and then read, the child understands hypocrisy of our behavior right away. He knows what we are doing. And to tell the child that, no, my behavior, the rules for me are different than the rules for you, child said, that is something difficult to understand. And then probably we never understand that, and hypocrisy keeps on increasing. I'm not saying authenticity can be 100%, but it's useful. It's useful to apply the same rules. So what we do, this competition is organized around the year. 31st August is the last day for every year. 15th October at Kalam's birthday year, and all these awards which we celebrate at Children Creative Generation Day. And then it comes to our campus, IIMA campus, in November, and gives away the award. He has a great connect with children, and in any case, and that works very well for children. So I'll show you examples of how children, the youngest child we gave an award was in class 1, from South Tamil Nadu, Virudhunagar. And how can children who have not yet learned to solve complex problems perceive the problem that our society has unsolved for a long time is something interesting that we need to see. So apparently the empathy, the ability to connect emotionally with things that are not right around us, and be able to become responsible to do something about it, is something innate among children. And I wish that attitude continues to remain with us when we grow up, so that we continue to be responsible to all the three things around us. Informal sector, we have pioneered Grassroots Innovation Award that our president gives every once in 2 years. And for last few rounds, these awards are given at Rashtrapati Bhavan, which is a great honor for common people, for our country to be honored at Rashtrapati Bhavan, and now in the same ceremonial hall, that other awards are given. So this is a very unique feature of our ocean ecosystem. Then there are awards for engineering students. There's a portal that Srishti has created, one of mentioned, called as techpedia.srishti.org, S-R-I-S-T-I.org. And this has more than 180,000 engineering projects, done by more than 500,000 students from over 600 institutions. And since independence, we never track the B-Tech and M-Tech projects in our country. So students are doing projects. Many of you are engineers, you must have done projects in your life. And many of them are good, because many good students are there. So they have good projects. And the paradox is that we never care to track these projects as to whether they could become the building blocks of new ideas, new solutions. So these projects never became the bricks of the building that we are designing. And what forgot? There was no way to keep them. So we said, no, we can't afford. In modern society, we cannot afford to do away with, throw them in the junk. 10 lab students pass out of the field. A million students are here. How can we afford to do that? So without caring about AICTE, without caring about UGC, a young student in NMI, who was at that time in NIT Surat, came to me and said, sir, he wanted to invite me for a lecture. And I said, look, I am a Shylock. I want my pound of flesh. So he said, what is a pound of flesh? I said, put some 5,000 projects together. And he did. Ultimately, he did 100,000. Now we have 180,000. And the very simple heuristic was used. They went to students during vacation, went to different colleges and professors, and said, do you want your students to do original work? Of course. Sir, but how would they do if they don't know what others have done? That's true. Sir, will you give us the projects done by your students so that we can share them with other students? And no professor said no. They didn't ask where is the order from director of the institute. They didn't ask where is the order from UGC chairman. They didn't ask where is the order from IIT chairman. That's what I tell about our system. That's a good thing about our system. Then professors, when academics see something good, they cooperate. And they did. And we could build a system where all IITs and IITs and all these projects are there. And then we select the top ones with the recommendation and jury process there, and many of you are involved. And these are given award every year. Thankfully, this year, only citations were given. This year, Department of Biotechnology, with this institution called as BIRAP, I know the proposal for that, and it was set up in 2007, Biotechnology Industry Research Assistance Council, the only body in our scientific establishment which invests in IITs. There's only one body. So that has been closed. So there is no other mechanism in the entire science ministry and departments other than BIRAP, which invests in IITs. Not even proof of concept, even the United States before that. And this is the pity that there's only one window. We should have such windows in all fields of technology. All fields of technology, we should have similar windows where good ideas must get investment. Very simple. But unfortunately, I cannot report to you any other such window from our country as yet. Hopefully, with your suggestion, when scientists come to your place for training, I think you should drop this point in that no matter which ministry you come from, unless we invest in ideas of young people, how will this country progress? So they have announced 15 awards of 15 lakh each for biotechnological innovation by students, and 100 awards of 1 lakh each for undergraduate projects that have some potential for taking it forward. Good institute, good relationship, I must say. Then we also did Inventors of India workshop. What I did was, in 1998 to 2008, I looked at all the patents issued to individuals. You know, in all, every year we file not more than 6,000 to 7,000 patents. There's a separate study that I have done of all the patents that Indians file in India and US compared to China. We are 1/6 or 1/7, sometimes 1/10 in some years of China's filing rate. Hardly 78,000 patents are filed by Indians in India, compared to 36,000 in all which are filed by others. And for a country of our size, it's not a good number. Nevertheless, we looked at them, went to those individuals who had filed, and discovered some very interesting things. For example, a lot of surgical innovations, human surgery, have been developed by surgeons, which is very similar to what has happened in the US and Europe. Most of the surgical innovation, more than 60% of the surgical innovations have been developed by surgeons even in the US. Vaughan Inputs, Walcott Sloan proves that. And in our country, I found a very simple pattern. So Dr. Bhave in Pune, who is an orthopedic, found that for a spinal injury,
you need to have 5 days of hospitalization in the West and $5,000 minimum without the cost of staying in the hospital. In India, he did it in 5,000 rupees and 1 day of hospitalization. He has 200 rupees needed to put in this, the hole that you have in the spinal cord. And cement has to put inside. So 200 rupees needed. So I call it factor of 50. Anything that they do in dollars, you can do in rupees. So that is the good goal of frugality, good goal of efficiency. Anything anybody can do. In fact, I would say our space program has done it in 1/10, one half of the cost, I would say. 400 crores versus 1,000 crores. So around less than half, 40% of the cost. So we have the capability to do things at a very frugal level, even in the complex system, but we have not leveraged it. And I think we should. There are institutional innovations and public service innovations. There's a Prime Minister's Civil Service Award on 24th of April. I have had the opportunity of talking at the forum 1 or 2 years, and I must say that while we give awards, but very seldom do we draw public policy implications from the actions of those public servants whose decisions we have considered worth awarding. That's the paradox. But sometimes it's diffused. So one collector who developed a system for scaling up generic medicine instead of branded medicine, which is popular in Rajasthan, ultimately could succeed in persuading the state government to make a state policy, and now many state governments are procuring generic drugs instead of branded drugs, which means the budget for the healthcare goes as much more, becomes much more. So generic drugs cost you, let's say, 1/3 sometimes, or half the cost of branded drugs, with no difference in quality. One should not get this impression. All Indian companies make 100% profit only by selling generics. There is molecule-based drug have just come out. One or two molecules have come out in Cadila and another company. They have not yet generated revenue. So all the revenue of entire drug sector of our country comes from manufacture and sale of generic drugs. So to say that generic drugs are bad means our manufacturing sector is bad. That's what it means. We have the highest number of FDA-approved manufacturing facility for drug in India. So it is not that we don't have a good system, but I'm just sharing that from an innovative decision of a public policy maker or servant to a state national policy takes a long time. And one of the purpose, I think, of a platform like NIAS would be to scale up those innovation public services which may have been spotted by individuals or scouted by individuals, performed by individuals. How can they be linked to the innovation system? Now I'll talk a little bit about Festival of Innovation, which is a very interesting initiative of our president. And for a week, this festival takes place where children come. We have a children creativity workshop at Slum Children and Ignite winners work together to solve problems. We have Gyathi Awards, Mandalayam Technological Innovation Award, we have Pioneer Award, we have Exhibition of Innovations. We also had last year joined head with ICMR and DBT to bring medical innovations a day. We had sanitation innovations for Swachhata. We had National Innovation Club meeting. So 1 week, whole celebration is going on. Celebrate. And then these are all open access for people who come to see Mughal Garden. So anybody who comes to see Mughal Garden, probably there's no ticket required, can come and see this exhibition. So it's a very positive effort. I'm very proud that our president has initiated this. And he has taken many other initiatives, which I think we all need to take pride in. And that shows that individuals can make a difference even at that level. So our president has initiated 5 or 6 things. One is, he has started, I don't know how many of you know, an innovation writer and artist, scholar and investigator. So, selected writer, one of them was from Vikram, who has the heritage cell in Bangalore. He was the scholar and investigator last year. Two writers, two artists, from artists, one of them was Manipur. And 10 innovators, including school children, college students, and farmers and artisans. Stay for 2 weeks as a guest of honorable president. NIF does the tax stuffing. So they are taken to meet the secretary in the cabinet office, they are taken to meet the ministers, HRB, women and child there, but all the different labs that are linked to their innovation, their directors come and meet them, visit them. These people from the Standard Institute, because very seldom we bring standards in tune with the innovations. This connection was missing in our country for a long time. So standards people come and see how can this innovation go up, because we may not have standards. I mean, naturally, for innovation, we will not have standards. So how do we create standards? A whole range of actors who can play a role in those innovations are brought together in 2 weeks. And so we've got COP President's office. Then another thing that he has started is inspire teacher interested program. You know, there are teachers disregarding the problem that we have in our respective institutions of governance or academia, you know, students, whatever the problem. There are always teachers who inspire students.